Suhasini, first of all, I would like to come to you. And what we are seeing today is when we talk about national security, it can be a post or a friendship request on Facebook to outright war. There are all kinds of things in between. So at the moment, the changes which we have seen, and these are like the signing of US-Afghanistan-Taliban deal or coronavirus in China, everything has a reflection on our national security. When we talk about Afghanistan deal, because it is something very new, how do we look at it in context of Pakistan, India, and Afghanistan? What are the challenges it presents? Because we have seen the release by Afghanistan Taliban, it does not address India's interests.
Thanks again, it's always lovely to be here. I make the joke once a year about this not being the Hindu, but the Hindu-ORF Policy Conclave. I think national security is at a turning point in many ways. You know, we've had the External Affairs Minister, as Jaishankar, address in the last few days what he thinks is the most important trend in the world today, and that is nationalism, national interest. If everybody is looking at national interest around the world, and he refers to different geographies, and India is, of course, one of those countries, then where does multilateralism, where does the idea of world order, of greater good, really come into what we see as our principles of foreign policy? Many have pointed out this was there even 100 years ago, where countries essentially took whatever was in their own national interest. In that sense, I think what you're seeing in the two agreements that were signed on Saturday, the US-Taliban agreement that was signed in Doha and the US-Afghanistan joint declaration that was signed in Kabul, you are seeing unequivocally the US signing something in what it sees as its own national interest. It has not actually looked at the national interest, I would say, of any other country when it comes to it. What were India's main concerns? One, that the democratic structure of Afghanistan must be maintained. The agreements do not actually refer to these. They, in fact, refer to the Ghani government, which has only just won an election, which India welcomed, as the other side. That means the Taliban releases certain prisoners, and the other side will do the same. It does not address very directly the problem of Pakistan's cross-border terrorism issue with Afghanistan. It says we'll have a little dialogue between both you countries to talk about it, which again cuts India out of the regional security architecture. Second bit of worry over there. I think the third bit of worry is going to be the mainstreaming of the Taliban that has been done without the kind of assurances India needs for its security. So when, amongst all the other things that they plan to do, they release members of the Haqqani network, and they delist members of the Taliban, including the Haqqani network, from the UN Security Council, as they plan to do by May 29th this year. We're not talking about some long-term deal. This is all happening in the next few months. That is something India needs to be concerned about most strongly, because we know that the groups that target India, of course, have had safe haven in Pakistan, but equally have been able to access safe havens in Afghanistan because of these groups. So I would say India needs to look very, very closely at what is going to emerge out of this. Many over here, I think Sushant certainly, Kabir over there, have been warning of what could follow if this deal does come about as was expected. Unfortunately, the deal that seems to have been signed is exactly what many expected and what most in India have feared.
Right. Sushant, I would want to come to you here. You've always had a very keen, very sharp eye on Pakistan. Now, we have seen after the signing of these deals, may I use the word, bloating in Pakistan. It has been going on, and this is like something like a gift to them. So how does India respond to Pakistan in this, when we are not even talking? Talking is an option or not, we do not know. How long we are not going to talk? And there are like supporters of dialogue and not having dialogue. Both the things are there, out there, and we don't know yet what the next step of the government would be. So in light of that, how do you see India responding? How do you see India should respond to it? And how to handle this new situation?
Okay, so before I start, I must have my two bits upon about the college, because I am a former student of this college. And frankly, I was really hoping that this conclave would be held in the auditorium, because while I was a student, and I was not a very distinguished student, it was always my dream to sit on the stage. That has been denied to me, but I'm taking a lot of vicarious pleasure by sitting on the lawns, because when I was a student, none of us were allowed to even step on the lawns. So now that we are holding this big thing on the lawns, it gives me great pleasure. So I think those things have cancelled out. But on the question which you are asking, see, the gloating is only to be expected. This is something which a lot of us have been warning, that any kind of weakness which is shown by the US or by the allies in Afghanistan, any kind of a withdrawal which takes place, without proper conditions, of peace being restored. And I personally am very skeptical about whatever peace agreement has been signed, simply because there are just too many loose ends. There are just too many moving parts, and anything can give at any point in time. The timelines which they have laid out are quite unrealistic. And in fact, just a day before the agreement was signed, and just yesterday, we've already seen carping sounds come out. But I think the process will continue in fits and starts. But I'm very skeptical about whether it will actually lead to peace, number one. Number two, the fact that jihadist groups around the world will see this as a huge victory. And the kind of fillip the jihadist activity is going to get is unparalleled. And the gloating in Pakistan and the gloating among some of the jihadist groups in Pakistan, which are aligned to the Taliban, was only to be expected. Now, how do we handle the situation? I think, one part of it has been that we have been remiss, in the sense that while we claim that Afghanistan is a matter of critical security interest to us, we have always tried to ride piggyback on other powers. So, during the Soviet times, we were riding piggyback on the Soviets. Later on, we were riding piggyback on the Americans. So there was only so much we could do. The second is, and this kind of irritates the hell out of me, as a $3 trillion economy, over the last 20 years, we keep repeating, as though we've done a great favor, that we have spent $2 billion in Afghanistan. $2 billion over 20 years is $200 million a year. Apparently, during the CWG games, we had a $10 billion scam. And we keep talking about $2 billion over 10 years or 20 years. And what the hell are we talking about? So the point is that, we need to really start investing in places and not talking too much about it, which is what we do. The third part of it is that I don't think we are out of the game. I think because there are so many moving parts, I think there are leverages that we can use, but provided we want to play that policy. But if you want to sit on the sidelines and wait and see how the cookie crumbles before you finally start acting in Afghanistan, then that's another option. I'm not saying that's a bad option, that's a good option, but that's an option. But I think one thing we need to be very clear about: no matter what happens in Afghanistan, the terrorists who are going to be based in Afghanistan are not going to dig a tunnel from under Pakistan or going to fly over Pakistan and enter India. Their route is Pakistan, and they will be brought in and thrown into India through Pakistan. So our problem remains what it was even before this accord, which is Pakistan. And that's a problem we need to handle on a very different plane than the problem the way we look at Afghanistan. And to look at Afghanistan purely from the prism of Pakistan, I think, is yet another mistake which we make. Pakistan is, of course, important, but I don't think our entire policy on Afghanistan should be centered only from the prism of Pakistan. And that is a mistake we have made. So I don't think all our cards are down. I think we still have cards to play. But we need to be able to, you know, seriously think through the next steps before we play those cards.
Right, I'll come back to you, Sushant, on this, and Suhasini, to you as well. But I want to go to Karthik now. Karthik, where does China figure in all this? Because we have seen yesterday Taliban has been thanking China as well, and China also has lots to gain from this.
Hello, thank you. Thank you very much, Kadamini. Thank you, and it's an honor for me to share this podium with Suhasini and Sushant. I want to thank all of you for also coming here and making your presence felt and to listen to me and the other panelists. The point that Kadamini raised about China's relationship with the Taliban and the Pakistanis, ultimately what the Chinese are doing is basically following Pakistan's lead by and large on Afghanistan. That's my sense. They are not going to upset the Pakistanis because they need the Pakistanis for so many other things. That apart, in terms of understanding the internal dynamics of Afghanistan, the complexities, I mean, it is very vexing. Why should the Chinese take so much trouble in trying to understand and trying to position themselves and conduct a policy that is independent of Pakistan, which they're never going to do? So anyway, in any case, the Chinese are fairly consistent in the way they stand, and that is more in line with the Pakistani position on the Afghan, on the Taliban, on the Afghan Taliban. So they are not going to do very much in terms of upsetting that. So I'll put it, that's the way I would frame it.
Okay. Suhasini, I would want to come back to you. As Sushant was saying, that there are enough cards on the table at the moment. But when we are not even talking to Pakistan, then how do we manage Pakistan?
Well, this is going to be the great conundrum. And I think what's happened is around the world, people have tired of asking us this question, including in our own region, which is when they say to us, you have not had a conversation with Pakistan. Can we help? Can we mediate? You say, no. This is a bilateral decision. We will talk to Pakistan bilaterally. So they say, so why aren't you speaking to Pakistan? And you say, no, I can't speak to Pakistan under the current circumstances. So you keep going around in this circle. Frankly, my sense is that most of the world has given up. They assume that India will do what it does and speak to Pakistan at its own time. I do think there is an opportunity cost to this. You cannot go on forever with this idea that I have my biggest problem with my neighbor to my west, but I will not have any conversation with him bilaterally. Then the second step that we had was I will not go to the SAARC summit, because the SAARC summit includes Pakistan and I am not going to speak to Pakistan bilaterally or in a regional format. So what is the third step? The third step is that we join the Shanghai Cooperation Agreement led by Russia and China. And who are we meeting with over there? Pakistan. So there are these constant contradictions in a lot of what we're doing when it comes to talking to Pakistan. At the end of the day, talking to Pakistan is not a solution, because we know that we've had 50 odd years or 60 odd years of that. But it certainly is, it seems unreal to assume, unless you're one of those who feels that a war is going to be inevitable, that no solution is going to come without some amount of talking. We can keep going around in circles on this. When it comes to the regional format, and you know, even Karthik referred to the China-Pakistan nexus. One of the big things that China's done in the last few years is to give Pakistan a promise, a commitment of $50 billion when it comes to the China-Pakistan economic corridor. This led to India saying we will not be part of the Belt and Road Initiative, because now China is recognizing parts of Indian-claimed Kashmir as parts of Pakistan. So at some point when there was talk of a kind of solution to this, an alternative to this, there was a Chinese, I think, a scholar or a commentator who came up with the idea of PACE, Pakistan-Afghanistan-China Economic Corridor, and said if these regional connectivity lines were actually to go around what India's real problem is with this area of Kashmir, maybe we can come up with a solution. This is also something India has not agreed to be in any discussion over. So we're left with a situation where we say we're fine, we are strong. When Pakistan hits us in any meaningful way, we hit back. We are conducting policies of regional connectivity with every country in the region except Pakistan. And we are building our relations with the big powers in the world and to everybody but Pakistan. It may be a situation that lasts in the short term. My sense is that in the long term, we're going to have to work up some new ideas. Because just as every country has its own, the thing that holds it back from becoming, finding its place in the world stage. I mean, China, for example, has enough internal contradictions that will hold it back from its eventual rise. I think India's eventual contradiction is going to be the inability to take all its neighbors on board with it as it seeks a greater rise.
Right. We have been hearing for a long time that we have managed to isolate Pakistan. That does not actually seem to be working. It doesn't seem very isolated.
Are you asking me?
Yeah.
I think in any case, the term isolate Pakistan, and you don't hear it anymore. Yeah. I think we heard it a lot in 2016. We heard it after that when we talked about doing away with SAARC and going with BIMSTEC. But we don't hear the government use the phrase isolate Pakistan anymore. I think that's just... That just seems to indicate that that's not a phrase that's working, because Pakistan, like all countries and all viable countries, has its links. It has its links to various parts of the region. I mean, recently we even had the former Sri Lankan Prime Minister come here and say, sort out your problems with Pakistan or somebody else is going to find a way to make you do that.
Yeah, and even Nepal has said that they are ready to mediate and everything. So, Sushant, when the situation is like that and we have had a Balakot, does it signify a shift?
We've had a what?
We have had a Balakot. So, does it say that now we are dealing only militarily and we are like not talking at all ever?
In a sense, we are talking, but not at the political level. There are missions in both countries. There is lines of communication open. You recently had this whole locust attack. So the two sides are talking to each other. Perhaps, those kind of things will happen. But are you talking about a political level dialogue? I don't see what purpose is going to be served from it. Mm-hmm. I don't see, you can talk to them, but what do you get at the end of it? And if you do some delving into... what used to happen on the issue, core issue, as I would put it, of terrorism, every time we've engaged the Pakistanis with any degree of seriousness, we've had a spate of terror attacks in India. Every time we've not spoken to them, the terror attacks have gone down. Now, it can be somebody's argument that, look, that means that you are going to be held hostage to terrorists who are going to sabotage every single initiative which you take. That might be so, but the point is that the terrorists in Pakistan are not autonomous organizations. No terrorist organization in Pakistan operates without the sanction of the Pakistani state, without the active support of the Pakistani state. The time the Pakistani state wants to bottle up the terror organizations, they do it in the snap of a finger, right? So you have had something happen in Kashmir on August 5. How many statements have you heard from all those terror organizations which used to be, going on the rampage in Pakistan against India? Not one. And the reason is because there is this FATF sword hanging over their heads and the Pakistanis have told them, yaar, please go into the background right now. Okay? So we need to be clear about what is the kind of entity that we are, facing in Pakistan. Number one. Number two, I have absolutely no objections in having a political dialogue with Pakistan, provided there is some telltale sign that you actually want to resolve issues. And you want to resolve issues not on the basis of putting a gun on my head, but you want to resolve issues in a basis of give and take, right? It has to be a realistic option. You cannot have a maximalist approach which the Pakistanis always adopt and then expect some kind of a solution. And you cannot expect that the Pakistanis will continue doing what they are doing and we'll keep turning the other cheek. See, we've turned the other cheek for the last 30, 35 years. I would go back to Punjab. If you want to be really, het up about it, you could go back to the 1940s. So this turning the other cheek business has to stop sometime. And I think Balakot has stopped the other cheek, number one. Number two, on the CPEC, let me just weigh in on that. See, what do we get out of the CPEC? If we want a road to China, we can have a road to China without having to enter Pakistan or Pakistan-occupied Kashmir. And for the Chinese scholar, I've heard this, you know, this space corridor kind of a thing. See, part of the problem is, and this is a problem even in India, so all of you guys who are going to get into strategic studies, international relations, the first thing, the single most important thing after, you know, learning the language is to be able to read an atlas. You know, people talk about doing things without having ever seen an atlas. And I think the Chinese scholar never saw the atlas. Because if I want to go to Kashgar, why the hell would I want to travel through Pakistan, go into Afghanistan, go into Tajikistan, go all the way from Uzbekistan and Kyrgyzstan and then enter China?
It took me 12 hours.
I've got to be stupid to do that, right? What do we need the CPEC for? We don't need it for anything. It's a corridor to nowhere. It's a corridor which links the Chinese to the Arabian Sea for whatever that's worth. It does not end the Chinese Malacca dilemma. It does not do anything for them, really. Maybe it gives an outlet to Xinjiang and some of those places. But beyond that, it does nothing. The rest of the corridor, which they are taking into, that's the larger BRI into Central Asia and other parts, that is a continental requirement and they need to do that. But other than that, what the hell does CPEC mean to us? It doesn't mean anything to us. It doesn't add any value to us. And if we want to do it, we can very simply, the Chinese are already building roads to Indian border, we can tell them, yaar, thodi aur aage le aao, hum niche tak le jayenge. Baat khatam ho gayi. Why the hell do we need CPEC? So let the Pakistanis stew in their own juice. Let them get projects for which they can't pay. And I don't have any problem for it. If the Chinese are going to, you know, keep them under their thumb, then I would rather deal with the Chinese and get my work done in Pakistan than deal with the Pakistanis and get nothing out of them.
When I went to Tibet in 2014, you were there, Suhasini, and we saw the railway lines which they had built through the stone and mountains. It was, the speed at which they were building was amazing, and the roads were like right there to Indian borders, and we were wondering how soon it would be when they would be standing at our doors. And you're right about Xinjiang, it took so many hours, and the Pakistanis who came there, they came within 3 to 4 hours. So that was really quite irritating. So when we are talking about CPEC, Karthik, so what Sushant is saying is it is not actually as if it is going to help China much, but it has irked India quite a lot. What is the Indian answer to it?
See, my view is that if you look at CPEC, the thrust is primarily strategic. I'm not too sure what economic gains the Chinese are going to reap, but it certainly, as Sushant put it, it gives them, gives the Chinese an outlet to the Arabian Sea. It gives them that opening. That apart, they do have a significant military relationship with Pakistan. They conduct the Sea Guardian joint exercises, which actually happened very recently. So they do have a very robust military relationship. You do have a Chinese presence on the Pakistani coast. Just in Karachi alone, you have joint sharing facilities, particularly naval facilities that are co-located, where even the Pakistanis do use a lot of Chinese naval equipment. So because of that, there is a considerable amount of interoperability. And so when you look at CPEC, you don't look at it purely from an economic angle, but you look at it from a strategic angle. And it is to some extent to mitigate some of the problems, strategic problems that China has in terms of access to the Arabian Sea, to the Gulf, and they do have a presence ultimately in the Horn of Africa. So they do want. So I think CPEC does play a role there, but beyond that, I don't see what else comes of it. Certainly not the economic side.
And what about INSTC?
Sorry, INSTC. The thing is about INST, the International North-South Corridor. The problem is, see, the issue for India at least is the only value it really brings for India in terms of reducing the cost of transportation. Mm-hmm. Now, we are spending huge sums of money in terms of, you know, ferrying stuff, say from Russia to India, by sea. Now, the North-South corridor helps us gain access to, you know, Central Asian states through Iran. And that does play a very important part. But I do think that this is something that you have to give more time to for the INST to play itself out. But it's one way to mitigate some of the kinds of energy-related or other relationships that we want to build, particularly with the Russians. But I'll leave it at that.
So, Ashni, would you look at it as more of a strategic thing than any other?
The INSTC or
both CPEC?
You know, just to clarify, I don't think the idea was that China would stop dealing with Pakistan directly and go through Afghanistan. I think the idea was that it would not be a part of the Belt and Road Initiative so as to alleviate India's concerns about this Belt and Road. But that's now all water under the bridge. India has said again and again they will not be part of the BRI. As far as the INSTC is concerned, I hate to be the kind of, you know, the sort of damp squab on everything. But at the end of the day, I see two basic contradictions when it comes to India explaining its relationship with regional connectivity and projects to its west when it talks about the INSTC. What does the INSTC basically hinge on? It hinges on trade from Bandar Abbas. What is India's biggest investment in that region? It is the port of Chabahar. So in a sense, straight away, the idea of us developing Chabahar, because we think Chabahar is going to help us get around Pakistan and get into Afghanistan and Central Asia, is put on the back burner if we talk about the INSTC, which I don't know if all of you are aware of, is the International North-South Transport Corridor that goes from Bandar Abbas in Iran all the way up to Central Asia and Russia, and is supposed to be not just a transport corridor for cargo, it is also supposed to work for oil. Now, the second thing is that whether or not we are talking about investing in Chabahar, whether or not we're talking about going through INSTC, obviously, as Sushant said, if you look at a map, you will see that it makes utmost sense. If you look at the geopolitics of our time, it makes zero sense. For the simple reason that India has decided to fold up its operations in Iran. It has decided to cave into American pressure when it comes to taking oil from Iran. So you are saying essentially that India has cut all its oil imports from Iran. It has therefore cut all trade with Iran because all our trade was being done on a barter service. In fact, you can go to Amritsar and meet tradesmen who are out of business, who are completely at the doors of poverty because they no longer have this opportunity for trade with Iran, and that was all that they were doing. So you've got this situation where you say, I have this great idea. I am going to connect with this port in Iran, go to Afghanistan. I'm going to connect with this other port in Iran and go to Russia and Central Asia and you know, completely do away, isolate Pakistan, do away with the need for Pakistan. And yet I'm not a part of the geopolitical structure there. I have walked out of dealing with Iran when it comes to buying their oil. I am giving in to the American agreement, which is this US-Taliban agreement, which essentially is going to make me wonder even whether we are going to have the same connectivity with Afghanistan. I mean, a post-agreement, you know, they refer to it as the post-agreement Islamic government, Afghan government, right? They don't even refer to Ghani as anything more than an interim government. They don't recognize the Ghani government. So we are talking about 1 year down the line, 14 months down the line, and Afghanistan we might not have a dealing with. So please explain to me what is our actual strategy when it comes to this INSTC, when it comes to Chabahar, when it comes to dealing with all these great places, because obviously it makes a lot of sense. Now, I don't think we need to be a part of CPEC. Clearly, we've already cancelled any connectivity that comes down from there in the form of the TAPI, the Turkmenistan, Afghanistan, Pakistan, India pipeline, because we can't deal with Pakistan. Simple, we don't trust them, they're always bombing us, we're sick of them, we are never going to deal with them. So then, give up this idea that you are going to deal around them, because you are now not dealing with Pakistan. Because of American pressure, you are now not dealing with Iran. You make lip service, you go there, you sign, you shake hands with them and come back. And you have this idea that you will deal with Central Asia, you will invest in Central Asia by the manner of the most expensive way of cargo transport, which is by air. We are now talking about air transport corridors, not just with Afghanistan, but with Central Asia. Anyone who will look at that map, who will look at the atlas, will tell you this is not something that is commercially viable. My problem with your question, you know, your questions on INSTC, but my problem with all of this is, however much we might make fun of other people's regional connectivity plans, our plans are not going great guns either.
Sushant, I want your comment on that.
Look, I entirely agree with what Suhasini is saying, but let me just try and give you a slightly different perspective. See, yes, Iran is important, but numbers are even more important. And by numbers, what I mean is that if we do trade of $150, $160 billion with the Americans, and because of that trade, we do a trade of another, at least $200 billion of trade with American allies. Are we going to jeopardize it all for a $14 billion trade that we do with the Iranians, out of which we buy oil of $12 billion? And I don't see how that is going to be possible, or how, you know, we can do some grandstanding on that issue and take on the Americans. Whether we like it or not, the Americans remain the hyperpower for the foreseeable future, number one. Number two, see, the Iranians also understand it. They might not like our predicament, but they understand where we are coming from. So what are we trying to do? And this is purely my analysis of the situation. It is that we are trying to keep the ball in the air. We are trying to keep the ball in play. Because if we say that, look, forget INSTC, we have nothing to do with it, Chabahar is never going to come about, Afghanistan is going to go out of the thing, we'll see when something else happens in Afghanistan. See, remember one thing, in Afghanistan there's never any end game. Every end game is the beginning of the new great game. Okay, so what we are seeing as the end game right now is a new great game which is going to start. Now, the moment that happens, we might need a Chabahar to enter back into Afghanistan at that point of time. So we have to keep these balls in play without necessarily having to always do something about it because of other compulsions. And those compulsions are important in international affairs. We might want to do many things which we can't simply because we are not in a position to do those. We have to look at our financial strength. We have to look at our capacities. We have to look at a whole lot of other things before we get into it. Our problem is that our policy making is so full of bombast. We pretend as though we have already arrived in the world when we remain a $2,000 per capita income economy. So, you know, our outreach and our grandstanding needs to be in conformity with our actual capacities and our strengths. Because while we might not like what the Americans are doing in Afghanistan, the question when we say this to the Americans, they turn back and say, so what is your equity in Afghanistan? Are you willing to put boots on ground? We say, sorry, we can't do. What else are you willing to do in Afghanistan? But you want the Americans to stay out there and do your dirty work for you. That's what the Americans tell us. So I think those are natural compulsions. I have absolutely no problem in getting the Americans killed so that I'm secure. But it doesn't normally work that way.
Karthik, would you want to add something to that?
Yeah, that's a very good point he made, particularly the last point. Last point he made, Sushant. See, the thing is that however disappointed you are, even I was about a decade ago, I wrote a piece for the IDSA. I was with Sushant at that time at the Institute for Defense Studies Analysis. But if you look at it, there was simply no way out. I mean, there was simply no way you were going to bring the Taliban to its knees. You were certainly never going to be able to subdue them. The Pakistanis were going to allow them to use their territory as a haven, train them, infiltrate them, and kill Americans. And it was a dead end. And ultimately, as long as we are not able to make any sacrifices, if we are not going to shed any blood, the Americans are going to see that, well, you guys are just using us as a cover, and you're sponging off us, and you contribute a bit, but you don't do much else beyond that. So it's the kind of argument that even many Americans have made about the Chinese themselves. For instance, the Chinese, whatever bit of mineral resources that Afghanistan has, for instance, I mean, there was a view, even held by Henry Kissinger, for instance, that why should we have a presence in Afghanistan, shed blood there, only to see the Chinese extract resources for no cost, for no real cost, except for their benefit. They're not shedding much. So I think that's very, very important to recognize. And it's just one of those realities. I wish it wasn't the case, but you have to remember, it is a landlocked country. It is also a very fissiparous country. And there was simply no way you were going to bring about that kind of cohesion necessary to sustain a viable government. And that part, it's a rentier state. It just relies on rents. And rents. So it's just that you extract money from external patrons. That's all it is. It was simply unsustainable in the long run. And it went on for nearly 19, 20 years. But it's very surprising that it lasted this long.
Okay, so
5,000 years it's been a war economy. 5,000 years. It's not going to change now.
So it's quite hot, and I can see yahan par sab usse folder se hawa kar rahe hain, but aap logon mein se kaafi log likh bhi rahe hain. That's quite good, and I think lots of questions would be coming in from there. But at the moment we just want to come to economy now, because what I am hearing, it's quite a gloomy picture we are presenting to our youngsters here. It may be like that, all black and black, not so colorful as this. So if we look at the economy, some years back we were saying that we are rivaling China and will surpass China as far as economy is concerned, and we will be there very soon. But now that the growth rate has gone down after demonetization, do you actually see it as a reality in very near future, Suhasini?
Okay, well, demonetization did what it did to our economy. We're still not sure what coronavirus is going to do to the Chinese economy. I think if you see in the, it's in the Times of India today, they have a graph of the kind of emissions China is emitting, which is, you know, it's got a perfect sky right now, zero emissions going out, zero flights over certain parts of the country. It is going to have an impact in China and on the Chinese economy. It's also going to have a global impact because China is so entrenched in the global supply chains. Is India going to be, is India going to go ahead of China? I think, you know, frankly, we do ourselves a disservice when we continuously make that the benchmark for two or three reasons. The first reason is that our growth is not China's growth. China has grown without any democracy. It has grown without the idea that it has to take people along with it. They just decide unilaterally, and it is put down there. The second part to that is really that India can be the best it can be without these comparisons only if it is able to look within. There was a period in China where the Chinese decided to, a silent rise and all of that. India has to have the space to do that. I think those who are constantly making the comparison between India and China are actually part of this nice Western idea that India is going to become that shoulder from which the gun to shoot China is going to be wrested. And this idea of constantly pushing up, the sense that India must rival China economically. Yes, India must grow. Yes, India must grow in a major manner in order to be taken seriously by global players, including China. But does India need to compare itself to China? I think, as I said, this is an external idea that many of us have internalized because it just sounds great. The idea that you are judged by not your friends, but who you decide to make a rival. So if we decide to make China a rival, then it's a question of whether we can surpass them. But our growth is different. Our ideas are different. Can we become a $5 trillion economy, a $10 trillion economy, by completely ignoring those who fall below the poverty line? My sense would be the India that has so far existed would not be able to. Maybe the new India will.
I would want to come to you on this. So as Suhasini is saying, it's not really feasible to compare both the countries economically. Would it be so militarily as well? We have seen increased Indian activity on the border areas, building of roads and all kinds of military planes over there. It has a more of a proactive push militarily as well on the border areas. So is there supposed to be a combination without rivaling?
I mean, the thing is that as far as India's own military efforts are concerned, they've been underway even before this government started came to power. My point is that it's still very limited. That apart, if you look at what we are doing, most of our forward deployed areas are supported by airlift capabilities. Hmm. Our road connectivity is still woeful. So I do not see, as far as roads are go and greater ground-based connectivity is concerned, that will take a long time, and that part, the resources would be fairly substantial, and the rate at which we do it is so slow. But what we've done in terms of our advanced landing grounds, greater frontline jets being deployed in the northeast, yes, there has been some uptick in that area. But as far as militarily comparing the two countries is concerned, see, pound for pound, it's a much stronger country, mm-hmm. China. There is simply no way you can, if you just do a head-to-head contest, it is straight head-to-head contest, it's much too strong. The only thing we can do is that try and protect those areas that we consider vital and concentrate our resources there. So that would be one part, would be the border. The other part, of course, and this is where it's going to become very tricky in the long run, or in the medium to long run, is the Chinese ingress into the Indian Ocean. Now, we've spoken about CPEC and how, you know, how that leads, helps the Chinese get into the Arabian Sea and things like that. But they are also working actively through Myanmar. There is something called the CMEC, the China-Myanmar Economic Corridor. One area is certainly the Kra Canal, where the Chinese want a presence. They want to be able to break the Malacca dilemma. They have been working fairly intensively with the Myanmarese government. But I do believe that will take some more time to crystallize. But it's certainly something that they want to be able to, if not completely overcome the Malacca dilemma, certainly mitigate it to a significant degree.
Yeah. Sushant, China does not have only a superior economy at the moment, and militarily it is superior, but there are other things as well. We have seen their cyber attacks. We have seen the propaganda which it puts through and takes like a whole lot of media groups there, even for Xinjiang. So where does India compare to that? Does India need to do something similar?
Absolutely not. And I completely agree with what Suhasini is saying, that you know, you have to look at the growth trajectories and the political systems of both countries separately. Please, I would hate for India to become another China, right? No way. I'm not, even I'll join Shaheen Bagh at that point of time. And I'm a trenchant critic of Shaheen Bagh. But look, the thing is, there are two, three things. Number one, on the economy. It's not just the Chinese growth, which is very impressive. I think it's the kind of stuff with the Chinese have done on technology, which is even more impressive. Although the military technology is still not the best, it's not even as good as the Russian one right now. But the fact is that they have made massive progress in terms of developing their own indigenous technologies, where we have faltered very significantly. Mm-hmm. That is one point. The second point is on the economy. Look, I am a trenchant critic of this government's economic policies. I agree with Suhasini that you have to have the kind of social welfare schemes which, you know, try and pull people out of poverty. But you also have to have wealth creation. You can't treat people who earn money in this country as like criminals, which is what we have been doing. Mm-hmm. This kind of voodoo socialism that has been so deeply ingrained in our heads, it's absolutely crazy. Most of these guys don't know this, but when we were in college, you know, nothing of what you guys enjoy was there for us. It was a nightmare. And I think we are contemporaries. You were across the road. Oh, okay, fine. Okay, you were the elite college. So I was, across the road people I'm not talking about, but, You know, the thing is that it was a nightmare when we had to call up our family in Punjab. I think my father used to shout so much that he thought there is, rather than the phone line, his voice would reach Amritsar. You know, that is the kind of nonsense we are talking about. That was socialism, right? Please forget socialism. It's the biggest curse this country has ever faced. Number one. Number two, so we need to create wealth. We need to create policies that allow people to make money. Only then will you have money for social welfare, and only then will you have money for beefing up your security systems. You will not have security if you have a weak economy, you will never have security. And that is the fundamental lesson which this government does not seem to realize. And they are so dependent upon, and many of you guys will become IAS officers and stuff and become another curse on this country. But the fact of the matter remains that the kind of voodoo economics which the IAS officers inflict on this country and a political leadership which follows their lead, it's absolutely crazy. So we need to get out of that. On the other thing, see, on the competition with China, I think we present a far more better model for the world than what the Chinese do. It's all very nice to be taken in by the glitz of China and, you know, the nice highways and the ghost cities which they have built. But the fact of the matter is, I would rather remain in India with all the chaos which is around me than live in China with everyone watching what time I go to the bathroom, what time I go to the school, whether I'm reading a book or whether I'm not reading a book. I don't want that kind of intrusion in my life. Why would anybody want that? So I would rather go with the Indian model, and I think the Indian model has far more to offer to the world than the Chinese one. But we need to get a little realistic. The kind of minefields which we have placed in the paths of our citizens, I think those need to be removed. And if it were up to me, and I've said this often, I would give a Bharat Ratna to every single businessman in this country. Because to do business in this country, in the face of all the kind of stuff which the bureaucracy, both lower and upper bureaucracy, does to people, I think they really are the bravest people in the world. Or maybe they don't have a choice.
You reminded me of two things. One, when I used to, in Kingsway Camp, Mukherjee Nagar, I used to line up in front of the telephone booth to call up home. God, that was bad. And the viral video, you must have seen this old woman in China who's being followed by a drone and asked to go back home. That was scary. Really, really scary. Well, at this point, let me see how many hands the people who want to ask questions. Can I see some hands? Okay. Accordingly, I'll assign time to that. Okay. So we'll have this discussion amongst panelists for like 5-10 more minutes, and then we'll go back to the questions from the students. Suhasini, Sushant has brought in something which is very controversial today, that is Shaheenbagh. And we have seen the violence in Northeast Delhi. So what is happening internally today in India, does it pose a security threat to us?
Interesting. And while this is not my subject, which is internal security threats, I think we live in a world where there is an increasing internationalization of a lot of things. So the first thing I will say is what we have seen at Shaheen Bagh, what we have seen in terms of the government's crackdown on CAA protesters, because let's be clear, it is a crackdown. If you go to take part in a protest, against CAA, you will most likely be either sent back by the police or even arrested. Or I see some Kashmiri students were charged yesterday in AMU for a protest. Others are thrown out of the country. Foreign students are thrown out of the country for Facebook protests on the CAA. Where is the pro-CAA protesters, if you like? I don't know what that means because it is already a law. Seem to be able to walk through the city saying "Goli Maro," and they are not touched. Now that the crackdown there, the fact that we've had the kind of pushback from the government on CAA, as well as I would say Article 370 and the kind of shutting down of Kashmir, because Article 370 can be the subject of a tabletop discussion. Does it mean anything? Do we need it? Is taking it away going to change anything? I agree with all of that. And if that decision is finally taken in Parliament, maybe then that is the final word on it, or maybe not. But all the restrictions that have followed, the arrest of chief ministers or the detention of chief ministers that has gone on for 8 months, now ridiculous charges of PSA against them. So that's the second part. And the general atmosphere created in the country that there is going to be a very, you know, sort of, this is a strong government, this is a government which has a very heavy hand and all. The first thing when it comes to the implications on India's security is there is a decided internationalization of many Indian domestic issues, many Indian internal issues. Now, you can say it's not our fault if somebody from the outside starts taking an interest in what's happening inside, but think about it, it has not happened in all these decades. At the United Nations Security Council since 1971, there has been no discussion on Kashmir. In the past year, there have already been two. Now you can say, oh, well, you know, they had the discussion, but they didn't have an outcome, or they didn't put it into a resolution. All of that aside, I'm just telling you, this was the past, this is now today. So while you do have India doing things it has never done before, it has crossed the LOC, it has bombed parts of Pakistan that are not disputed Kashmir, it has pushed back in every single way that it possibly can and shown its might to China and Doklam, all the rest of that. At the end of the day, you are seeing an internationalization of India's internal issues that you have not seen before. And I would say this is part of the security threat to us. The second part is the idea that international terror organizations will try to make common cause with people they see as the victims of the violence inside India. We have already seen ISIS, Al-Qaeda, and others, and Kabir will tell you much more of that, try to play that game already in the last few months. Now, they have not succeeded over the last 20 years, I will say. We have seen Al-Qaeda make a lot of noise about India, but eventually, there was really no Al-Qaeda presence in the country. We saw ISIS make a lot of threats about India. We had an FBI team come here and tell us, oh, ISIS is coming, ISIS is coming. Eventually, the ISIS-affiliated terror group in Kashmir, I'm not even saying rest of the country, had less than 10 people in it. There were a whole bunch from Kerala, and you will hear much more about that. But we have not seen, given the strength of the minority population in India, we have not seen any of these pan-Islamic, you know, belief in the Ummah, terror organizations have the kind of impact in India that we have seen before. Is that going to be challenged because of the domestic issues? I think that's definitely the second threat. I think the third threat is a regional threat, and we need to take it seriously. You know, we say to ourselves that what we are doing is our internal issue. Who are the first people who stand up to defend us? Bangladesh. Second, who stands up to defend us? Maldives. Sri Lanka. Okay, Bhutan is always with us, so I will leave Bhutan out of this equation. Even if you forget Pakistan, we do. We don't depend on support from our region, but we certainly are bolstered by the support that our neighbors have been giving us. Is that kind of goodwill being taken for granted in India? When our Home Minister says again and again that he is essentially sees people coming from Bangladesh as termites, what kind of impact is that having inside Bangladesh? What impact did the CAA have on our ties with Bangladesh? Yesterday, the Speaker of Bangladesh canceled her visit to India. She's only the fourth Bangladeshi ministerial level person in the last 3 months to refuse to come to India. What does this mean in the long run? So I would say that there are these three impacts on India's internal security that we have to take much more seriously. Right now, we are working on the idea that if we can manage tomorrow's headline, if Mr. Trump can come to India and say, I'll leave this to India to do, we are secure for the next few years, I think we're making a huge mistake and we're doing a disservice to the next generation.
Sushant, you would want to add something?
I agree that I think all the three things which Suhasini has dealt with, international, internal, and regional, I think that I completely agree with it. The only difference of opinion is that, you know, the fact that if India is what, the fifth largest economy in the world, India's engagements with the world have increased over the last 15, 20 years, quite a lot. So much so that, you know, when we talk about the economic slowdown, we very often forget that about 40% of our GDP today comes from foreign trade. So if international trade starts going into a bit of a tailspin, our GDP will also fall. So some of the numbers which we are seeing, 4.5, 5% growth rate, is also because what's happening in the rest of the world. But having said that, it also means that we are going to be subject to greater international scrutiny. Now, should we, tilt at the windmills every time a Guardian or a New York Times writes an article? I'm not sure we need to. I think our problem has been much more that we haven't been able to put our side of the story very well. Part of the problem, we haven't been able to do that, is the way we've handled things within the country. But part of the problem is also, strategic communications system which really is sorely lacking. But the point is that, let me take you back to 1971, and this story is quite instructive. 1971, just before the war, the Indira Gandhi government had thrown out the BBC from New Delhi because the BBC was doing very pro-Pakistani propaganda, and like just as the BBC is doing today, anti-India propaganda. But they had been thrown out. Swaran Singh was then the foreign minister, and he was a wizened old politician. He had gone to the UK for a visit, and out there at the embassy, he was told by some people that, we are getting terrible press because, there is the Times is writing something, the Telegraph is writing something against India. So Swaran Singh, the wizened old politician, adjusts his pug, and then he says, tell me something, I fight my elections in Ludhiana. How many people read the Times in Ludhiana? So that was the reality, and that is the reality even today. Okay, but the point is that yes, a perception is being created, and that perception needs to be handled. The criticism of India is really not so much in what the steps we have taken. 99.9% of the people have not even read what the Citizenship Amendment Act is. They read the term Citizenship Amendment Act and they think we have amended our citizenship rules in a way that the minorities in India are going to be disenfranchised, which is utter nonsense, right? But that is the perception which has gone. The other thing is that the negative perceptions, no matter what you do, there is also a certain ideological bias in the rest of the world which is reflected, and we can handle that. The governments, however, haven't really been leaning upon India to change anything insofar as Kashmir is concerned. The issue, however, remains what Suhasini pointed out, the incarceration of political leaders who are bona fide political leaders. We might not like what they have done in Kashmir, we might not like their politics, we might not agree with them, but to keep them endlessly in jail is unconscionable, according to me. Secondly, to keep the kind of communication lockdown, I can understand the importance of a communication lockdown in a surcharged atmosphere. And, last night we saw all sorts of rumors floating around of riots having broken out in West Delhi. And it was all, this whole social media business. So I can understand that. But the government needs to get its act together on how people can use these platforms, and yet they are not, they don't become a weapon against India. On the internal thing, and I think that is the most crucial, social harmony within India is a necessity, is a national security imperative in my view. I am a statist. I believe that anybody who steps out of line, anybody who harms the security of other people in this country needs to be dealt with an iron hand. I don't care whether that's in Shaheen Bagh, and I don't care whether it's those guys who are taking out demonstrations in Connaught Place and yelling out slogans of Goli Maro. I don't care. Both need to be handled with firmness. In fact, lat chalao and get the work done. I strongly believe in it. But the point is that you have to bring in social harmony, because without social harmony, you don't get investments, you don't get jobs, you don't get trade, everything suffers. So it is a national security imperative to have social harmony in this country, and that is being threatened. And finally, on the regional question, I again entirely agree with what Suhasini is saying. And part of the problem is the way we have communicated certain things to our neighbors, that it's created problems out there. And even if the governments agree, that the governments understand what is happening out here, at the mass level, the perception which has gone out is pretty negative, and that needs to be addressed. I don't think the final word has been said on it, but I think that is something that the government, not only this government, every government has to have a very coherent strategic communication strategy, so that these things, these perception wars, can be handled much better.
Karthik,
I won't elaborate as much as Suhasini and Sushant have said, but I will certainly say, I'll make a certain point, a few points about internal security, although that's not my domain really, but I come from the city of Hyderabad. I've seen it myself. I mean, my parents eventually put me in boarding school in Ooty, but I could rarely attend school because of communal violence. And this was in the early 80s. I mean, we had Anjaya ruling Andhra Pradesh, then Andhra Pradesh, of course, now it's Telangana. But it was extremely difficult. I mean, even in parts of the city which are fairly affluent, fairly secure, you really couldn't go out very much because it was so dangerous. The point I'm trying to make is essentially that if you do not preserve a certain amount of harmony internally, given the kind of diversity we have, then we are staring at serious problems. And the points that the other two illustrious speakers have spoken about, you know, in terms of investment, in terms of the impact it has on the social fabric of the country, and it will sow the seeds of something that we cannot manage down the line. Okay, for now it's okay, but maybe 10, 15 years down the line, it may become a challenge for us. So I think that's something that you have to really preserve, and you have to ensure that you crack down on groups and elements that are taking to violence or threatening violence, whether it's on social media or going out on protests and things like that. So that's what I would say. But the larger points about regional issues and more about the external dimensions about our security, yes, by and large, I concur with the speakers. The only thing that I would certainly want to see is that if we can grow the economy, if we need to grow the economy, we also have to bear in mind that there are substantial resources that we will have to invest in areas that there are too many constituencies in this country that will prevent it from happening. For instance, if you want greater indigenization, you have to spend a lot of those resources on developing indigenous capacities. Unfortunately, we are developing greater dependencies on other countries. We have supplanted the Russians with the Americans in terms of purchasing weapons. So where does that leave us? Okay, you've just replaced one country with another. That's all. So where does indigenization stand? So these are things that we will have to address very, very much. But ultimately, we need greater resources, and that can only come with growth, greater reforms, and that will help us with our defense preparedness and national security.
Thanks a lot. And now we don't have much time, only 10 minutes. So we would want to take as many questions as possible. And I would request our panelists to keep the answers short. So just raise your hands and mention your name and college, please.
Very good afternoon, ma'am. Myself, Devansh Trivedi from University of Delhi Shivaji College. My question is about Taliban region. A couple of days ago, there was an article published in New York Times by Sirajuddin Haqqani, in which he stated, like a constitution, father of Taliban, that's okay. We think that is a pact signed between the United States and Afghanistan-led government. But does the Taliban, who is just a fundamentalist, led the Afghanistan destiny, means they are saying that we are maintaining the international relations, we are going to equal rights to women. Does it mean that they are the constitution maker of Taliban, of Afghanistan, or the real entity, real power is in the underhand of Afghan-led, Afghan-owned, Afghan-controlled Afghanistan government?
Suhasini, would you want?
Sure, very quickly, you're absolutely right. I think over here, we are all very concerned when we see someone like Sirajuddin Haqqani. Remember, the Haqqanis have Indian blood on their hands as well, not the least the 2008 Indian embassy bombing in Kabul. So when we see somebody like that being mainstream, there is a lot of worry over here. I think these are the questions that India has been asking. This has been the message from India. Don't give up the gains of the last 20 years. Amongst those gains were the fact that that Afghanistan had two, and okay, I will also say the third election that was held last year, although it had a very small turnout. was held. The Taliban has so far given no commitment to what is the next form of government going to be. Who is going to decide this form of government? So I do think that these are issues that we had thought would be included in what we saw as negotiations that have gone on. You know, today the External Affairs Minister said the US-Taliban agreement is like watching trailers of Pakiza for years, because Pakiza took 15 years to finally be made. But you know, the truth is it's a gruesome ending if you go by just the drafts that have been passed around.
Do you not?
Someone else, please. Let others also ask questions. There, yeah. Right behind you.
My first question is to Ms. Suhasini Haider. So, like Mr. Sushant Sareen, earlier he talked about investing in places. What are these places do you think India can invest in order to make its presence felt more? And second question, Mr. Sushant Sareen, you've talked about doing away with socialism. Until 1991, we've seen India economy more or less a socialist economy, a lot of restrictions. And but if you looked at economies like South Korea, United States, which are now capitalist, it has a history of being a socialist economy. There were a lot of restrictions on imports from foreign countries. And second question to Mr. Sareen.
I think that would be enough. Two questions is more than enough. Sushant, can you please?
You don't have to follow the same model with the South Koreans or some of the other countries followed. But let me tell you, life before 1991 was a miserable life. You know, my father, before he died, booked 15 telephones. Because he said, when my kids start their life, at least they should have a telephone. To get a telephone, if you didn't have connections, you had to wait for I don't know how many years. For a damn Bajaj scooter, you had to wait for 3 years, yaar. You know, it was nightmarish. The point is that you opened up the economy, you pulled more people out of poverty by bringing in sensible economics rather than voodoo economics of socialism. You brought in more people, you created more prosperity in this country. That is what you need to do. You don't have to follow the South Korean model or the Taiwanese model, which were authoritarian states, which then took to capitalism, which also indulged in a lot of crony capitalism. You don't have to do all that. But you also don't need to do the kind of nonsense which we are doing of, you know, bringing in the public sector on everything, making a Babu sit on every decision which any businessman has to take. You need to do away with that as well. So that's what I'm talking about. That's what I mean, this socialism kind of a structure. It's actually a mindset socialism. It's not even a policy anymore. And when that mindset becomes policy, it becomes a nightmare.
To your question about where should India invest, I would say invest regionally and invest smart. One of the things that we don't seem to realize, you know, we always talk about dumping of goods by China being a real worry for India. But when we compare India's trade balance with its neighbors, it is entirely in India's favor. In fact, 85% of our trade with all our SAARC neighbors is actually Indian exports to those countries. I think when it comes to that, instead of investing, just do away with duties and tariffs entirely with our neighborhood. Take unilateral, I don't want to use the word as, you know, it's not philanthropic decisions, but take decisions which denote India's large heart. We have a case of of the Sri Lankan Prime Minister who just came here a few weeks ago asking India to put a moratorium on debt repayment for 3 years. We have still not responded. I fear that our response is going to be no. So what I'm saying is show your big heart. If you want to make an impact, show that you are not nickel and diming your region, that you are actually willing to show a big heart and take leadership of a region without saying, what are you going to do for me? Because that will come in the larger scheme of things.
Right. There's a question there.
Hello, yes. My name is Rohit. I'm from Shamlal College. My question is how we engage with Pakistan. While Chinese or Americans directly speak to army chief, the real power to Pakistan, why don't we directly engage with the army chief Indians?
Your question is to?
Anyone can answer.
Susha, okay.
Yeah, I love this question because it's been asked so many times. But here is my own thing is, that, you know, this has become a kind of an excuse. Let's talk to the army chief. The Americans have been speaking to the Pakistan army chief for the last 18 years, asking him to do more to stop their support for the Taliban. It hasn't done a lot of good to the Americans, has it? The point is that, you know, you can talk to anybody in Pakistan, provided there is a sense out there that they need to solve those issues, that they come on the table with a certain degree of sincerity. But if their positions are going to remain what they are, if the Pakistani mindset on India remains what it is, that they want to, that they look there at their conflict with India as a civilizational conflict, then regardless of whether you talk to the army chief or the prime minister or whoever else in Pakistan, it's not going to lead you anywhere. Just as it hasn't led the Americans anywhere on fundamental issues which they wanted to resolve with the Pakistanis. So I think this is an excuse which has now started being made, that why don't we talk to the army chief? It will not lead to anything until and unless there is a paradigm change in the policy and the strategy of the Pakistanis, that they actually want to kiss and make up with India. Until that happens, regardless of who you talk to, it's not going to lead to anything.
I think we have run out of time, and I hope this discussion has been useful to you and you have enjoyed it. Thanks so much to my panelists, and thanks to all of you for hearing it out so patiently. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much.